Between 1914 and 1918, over 20 countries spanning 6 continents would declare war, producing World War I, commonly referred to as the Great War, the first genuinely global battle. Russia, Britain, and France established the Triple Entente, sometimes referred to as the Allied Powers or just the Allies. In contrast, the Central Powers, usually referred to as the Triple Alliance, consisted of Germany, Italy, and Austria-Hungary. The Ottoman Empire and Bulgaria joined the Central Powers, the United States, Japan, and many other countries joined the Allied Powers. Italy switched sides during the war, and Russia withdrew completely as a result of a revolution at home. These alliances, however, were hardly static. The Allied Powers prevailed by the conclusion of the war in 1918, but the magnitude of the carnage left both sides in shock. Long-range artillery and toxic gas were two new technologies that brutally increased the intensity of warfare. While the civilian death toll probably approached 10 million, 9 million military perished. In addition, combat destroyed infrastructure, infectious diseases spread like wildfire, and the war's enormous financial cost left Europe's economy in ruins. Many questions arise when we try to understand all this death and destruction. In this video we will answer two of them. Why did World War I start on a continent that was previously largely peaceful and prosperous? And how did World War I change the world? Follow the video with us to discover the solution, and don't forget to hit the like and subscribe buttons. Let's go! A patchwork of rival European empires and kingdoms had been at war with one another for centuries, driven by conflicts centered around territory, colonies, religion, resources, and dynastic rivalries. The result was frequent border shifts within the continent. However, in order to put an end to the never-ending cycle of conflict, representatives from several European powers gathered in Vienna in 1814 and 1815 following a string of military campaigns to overthrow the French Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte, who had taken control of most of Europe. What surfaced was a sequence of accords and comprehensions that signaled the beginning of an exceptional phase of comparatively stable conditions for the continent. Europe had a century of great advancement and influence on the world stage thanks to domestic peace. The continent benefited from technological advancements such as the creation of machines, steel, electricity, and modern chemistry. Meanwhile, nations were able to project their power farther abroad thanks to advancements in railroads, shipping, and armaments. Consequently, throughout the 19th century, most of the world was under the authority of Europe's greatest empires, which included Belgium, Britain, France, the Netherlands, Portugal, and, later, Germany, Italy, and Russia. This era of prosperity and peace in Europe, though, was short-lived. Many historians contend that a series of regional conflicts and wars to unite Germany and Italy marked the beginning of the unraveling of events in the mid-1800s. But without a doubt, World War I marked the disastrous end of Europe's century of stability. Let's examine the three main causes of this massive unraveling. 1. The German ascent. Europe saw a rough balance of power on the continent after the Napoleonic Wars. Stated differently, the strongest nations in the region tended to stay out of major conflicts with one another because of their relative strength. This meant that any anticipated benefits of war would almost certainly be outweighed by their costs. Peace and order were initially maintained by the might of Austria, Britain, and Russia. Later, as the two strongest nations on the continent, Britain and Prussia, which would merge to form Germany in 1871, preserved this equilibrium. Both countries boasted sizable populations, formidable economies, and strong armed forces. In the latter part of the 19th century, however, the balance of power changed once more. In the middle to late 1800s, Britain, the largest empire in the world as well as the most powerful naval and economic force, saw a decline in its relative strength. Through its close trade ties, unrivaled navy, and vast empire, which gave it access to markets and natural resources all over the world, Britain had long-standing dominance in the world. But the expenses of upholding such a large, global empire started to rise. Furthermore, by the end of the 19th century, Britain, which had previously held a manufacturing and technological advantage over the rest of the world, was being overtaken by quickly industrializing nations like Germany and the United States. It wasn't until Otto von Bismarck, the Prussian leader, united 39 independent states, a group of people who were somewhat similar in language and culture but not in religion, into one political entity that Germany became a sovereign nation in 1871. Through industrialization, this newly united Germany would soon become opulently wealthy and start to assert its dominance on the international scene by acquiring colonies in Africa. Later leaders would prefer to concentrate on establishing German dominance regardless of the consequences, despite Bismarck's efforts to maintain peace on the continent by balancing among the other powers. Historians have noted that Kaiser Wilhelm II was a conceited and insecure man who eventually acted recklessly due to his unbridled ambition to claim Germany's place in the sun. He renounced the reinsurance treaty with Russia in 1890, for instance, which caused Russia to make friends first with Britain and then with France, Germany's longtime foe. Wilhelm tried to bring his vision of German economic and military domination to pass by speaking outspokenly, sometimes even angrily. He made significant investments in military spending in particular, intending to create a navy that would rival Britain's renowned fleet on a global scale. The quick militarization of the continent sparked an arms race that upset the balance of power in Europe. 2. Nationalism. People are brought together by nationalism, a strong force, by shared linguistic, ethnic, geographic, or other traits. It can provide a foundation for a nation's social cohesiveness, inclusivity, and unity under some circumstances. However, nationalism can exacerbate violence, polarization, and world chaos when it is overdone. Nationalism stoked fierce competition in Europe in the years preceding World War I. The most powerful nations on the continent regularly competed with one another using their empires, armies, and technological advancements. In the meantime, assertions of each nation's supremacy were reaffirmed by governments, the emerging mass print media, and educational institutions. Countries saw war as a quick and simple way to achieve glory, with memories of the Napoleonic Wars long since fading. Some Europeans even rejoiced when World War I broke out. Parades and applauding onlookers sent their soldiers off to fight. In an eager attempt to not miss the chance to serve, young men raced to recruiting offices. The general consensus was that the boys will be home by Christmas. Few people anticipated that the war would continue in such a horrifying manner for 4 years. While nationalism brought dangerous unity to nations such as Britain, France, and Germany, it also tore apart other European empires. With their populations' enormous internal differences along ethnic, cultural, linguistic, and religious lines, Austria-Hungary, the Ottoman Empire, which included Turkey, portions of the Balkans, and the majority of the Arab Middle East, and Russia in particular, found it difficult to foster a cohesive national identity. Actually, one of those multi-ethnic empires was the site of the first shot in World War I, which was the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria, carried out in the name of Slavic nationalism. 3. Alliance networks. Franz Ferdinand's assassination might have stayed a small-scale, regional incident. After all, the greatest powers on the continent, Britain, France, Germany, and even Russia, were not directly impacted by the attack. Instead, it involved Serbia and Austria-Hungary, two lesser powers. But years before the assassination, European leaders had been building an alliance network based on the concept of collective security, which regarded an attack on one nation as an attack on the alliance as a whole. The idea behind those alliances was, in theory, to prevent war by making a stronger nation less likely to attack a weaker one if the latter had the backing of a potent ally. Actually, the alliance networks had the opposite effect, making a regional problem into a crisis affecting the entire continent, since Germany, Serbia, Russia, Britain, and France were all behind Austria-Hungary. A week following Franz Ferdinand's murder, Kaiser Wilhelm II of Germany promised Austria-Hungary complete support in retaliating to the attack in any manner it saw fit. On July 28, 1914, Austria-Hungary declared war on Serbia with this so-called blank check assurance. A few days later, France, Germany, and Russia followed suit with their own series of war declarations. As a result, Europe moved closer to war, or, as one historian describes the results of poor judgment, the continent found itself sleepwalking toward World War I. I don't need to remind you, my friend, before we move on. Remember to subscribe if you want to see the further portions. I'm grateful. The First World War caused enormous destruction. The war to end all wars ultimately accomplished nothing of the sort, which is perhaps the most tragic aspect of all, as the fighting and its aftermath planted the seeds for a second, even deadlier, World War that broke out barely 2 decades later. Despite the fact that World War I did not end current hostilities, it did change society in the United States, Europe, the Middle East, and sub-Saharan Africa. Let's examine a few instances. New Age of Warfare, a new era of deadly military technology, including landmines, flamethrowers, submarines, tanks, and fighter planes, was introduced by World War I. Both sides were able to produce intricate maps of their opponents' locations thanks to aerial photography. Soldiers could fire at enemies they could not see thanks to long-range artillery. Additionally, the development of WMDs, such as chemical gas, was an effort to end trench warfare's entrenched stalemates. Tens of thousands of veterans suffered from crippling psychological trauma, known as shell shock at the time and now more widely known as post-traumatic stress disorder, as a result of the scope and intensity of such combat. Additionally, World War I was a total war, blurring the lines between military and civilian targets, whereas earlier wars were mainly confined to the battlefield. For instance, Germany attacked civilian ships with submarines and bombed British cities with zeppelins, which are airships. Mass executions and the expulsion of specific ethnic groups, like the Armenians from the Ottoman Empire, were other aspects of the war that many historians would later refer to as genocide. Innovations beyond the battlefield. War gave rise to numerous medical procedures, everyday household objects, and new types of weaponry. The first successful skin grafts and the use of sodium citrate by medical professionals to prevent blood clots during World War I laid the groundwork for contemporary plastic surgery. Furthermore, the development of splints significantly decreased the lethality of some injuries. Prior to the war, 4 out of every 5 soldiers suffering from a broken femur would die. Following the splint's introduction, 4 out of every 5 soldiers survived. Along with these developments, the Great War saw the rise of print cartoons, which served as military propaganda and helped civilians and veterans process the horrors of war, the invention of exercises like Pilates, which a captured German bodybuilder used to stay in shape, and the development of Kotex, one of the first branded sanitary products, used as a cheaper and more absorbent wartime alternative to cotton bandages. Daylight saving time. While essays from decades ago argued in favor of its implementation, daylight saving time, DST, was only intended to be a temporary fix, having been developed during World War I to conserve energy and free up more daylight hours for battle. Benjamin Franklin made the case in 1794, citing financial, candle cost savings, productivity, longer workdays, and moral, a remedy for laziness, terms. Despite the fact that DST was largely abandoned after World War I, it was quickly reinstituted and made popular as a long-term fix as a result of the Second World War. In the midst of a worldwide energy crisis, the year-round DST that we observe in the United States was instituted in the winter of 1973. Vegetarian sausage. These items from the modern grocery store were non-existent prior to World War I. Konrad Adenauer, the mayor of Cologne at the time, came up with the idea for vegetarian sausages, which were produced in sausage-loving Germany during the war as an inexpensive way to add protein to meals amid frequent food shortages. His infamously bland Kölner Wurst, or Cologne sausage, were made with soy, flour, corn, barley, and ground rice. Even though they now have much improved texture and flavor, meat alternatives still use a lot of the same components as Adenauer's original formula. Plastic surgery. Prior to World War I, there were few options available to those with disfiguring injuries. But as the quantity and severity of facial disfigurements among First World War soldiers increased dramatically, the medical community moved rapidly to develop reconstruction techniques. The use of a patient's own facial tissue to reduce the risk of transplant rejection is attributed to Dr. Harold Gillies. This approach has led to a rapid advancement in the field of plastic surgery, enabling successful skin grafts, everyday words and phrases, the next time you ace an exam, get shell-shocked news, or the much-anticipated movie turns out to be a dud, you're employing terminology that was directly translated from the war. English gained terms from World War I, such as lousy, which became a word for tiredness from its original use as an adjective to describe lice infestations, and trench coat, which went from being a necessity on the battlefield to becoming a widely used fashion statement. Household brand Spam, a combination of the words spiced and ham, and Jeep, derived from the initials GP, which denoted its wartime origins as a general-purpose vehicle, were added during World War II. A mingling pot of cultural concepts and lingo was also produced by the global entanglement. For instance, Indian soldiers who fought alongside the British in World War I are directly responsible for the term cushy, which refers to something privileged or comfortable. wristwatches. The majority of us had to take out our pocket watches in order to perform this crucial duty before we could check the time using the phones in our pockets. For soldiers in the trenches, who were also operating without factory whistles and church bells to orient themselves in time, that proved to be quite inconvenient. The obvious solution to this issue is a wristwatch. Prior to World War I, wristwatches were considered feminine accessories, but this quickly changed as they were integrated into soldiers' equipment. The expression, "synchronize your watches," came to represent their significance in combat, where combat had to be precisely planned and timing was an essential survival and communication tool. Newsreels, one of the earliest types of broadcast, are the source of the 24-hour news cycle. People would wait in line at movie theaters to watch hour-long loops of news and entertainment features if they didn't have televisions, cell phones, or social media. At the beginning of World War I, newsreels primarily covered parades, sporting events, and cultural occasions like royal weddings rather than reporting on the war because early video cameras were heavy and cumbersome. However, as the conflict dragged on and the public became more and more hungry for updates, newsreels started to air footage from the battle, featuring then unprecedented imagery, the firing of military ships, people running from their villages, prisoners of war, devastated battlefields, which raised awareness of the devastation caused by war. Changing roles for women, women's roles in the workforce at home grew as Europe's armed forces sent millions of men to fight on the front lines. As thousands of women worked in factories, offices, and farms to support the war effort, they experienced a taste of financial and personal independence. Between 1917 and 1920, women's rights organizations successfully lobbied for suffrage, voting rights, in several nations by citing these important contributions. Organizations advocating for workers' rights also emphasized these initiatives, by men and women alike, to build stronger unions and increase collective bargaining power. During the war, women's fashion also underwent changes. Government requests that women stop purchasing corsets due to metal shortages resulted in the invention of brassieres. Additionally, as more women started working outside the home, they wore more and more factory-safe clothing, like pants. It's true that not all women during this period saw economic advancement. At least 3 million women lost their spouses to World War I, and many of them experienced severe financial hardship as a result. The end of World War I. World War I brought about the collapse of four empires, the Austro-Hungarian, German, Ottoman, and Russian. The winners of World War I frequently absorbed land from those erstwhile empires. The Ottoman Empire's land was divided by Britain and France. As part of the terms of the 1919 Treaty of Versailles, a peace agreement that established the parameters for the end of World War I, Germany was compelled to give up its colonies in the Pacific and Africa. In addition to the rebirth of some older European nations like Poland, the dissolution of these empires also gave rise to new nations like Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia. After World War I, the United States became the new center of power across the Atlantic, severely weakening even the victorious European nations. The US economy had overtaken Britain's as the largest in the world even before the war. The United States emerged from the war in an even more powerful position, ideally positioned to influence the emerging international order. But at the time, the American people showed little interest in taking the lead internationally, and the nation withdrew into an isolationist era.